All right, another thing is the inlets and outlets. First of all, the inlets and outlets I have doubled. On each side, I have an inlet. On each side, I have an outlet. The reason I did that was after testing a while, I just found that that kept the cell really flooded and it kept the gas flowing out at a fast rate. All right, and now when you're drilling holes to put your fittings in, obviously, you got to use a drill bit, the proper size drill bit for your whatever fitting you choose to put in. But the right way to do it is to actually buy the proper tap that is fitted for the fitting you're using. And that's the proper way to do it. I don't do it that way. I just drill the hole. I take my heat gun that's got a variable temperature setting on it, and I can get the plexiglass to soften up just beautifully where it's soft enough where I can even start it by just hand threading it in, and then I tighten it the rest of the way with a wrench, and it bites really nice. And then I use goop to fill in any cracks that were there. Not that there's any cracks, but use goop as a sealant. Okay, now the wiring. Just make sure you don't play around with cheap ass small wiring. Use the thick gauge wiring, the thickest gauge you can find. The thicker, the better. It's always good to have more than less with electricity. So now, this is what's running this diamond cell. You got the positive terminal and negative. I take these battery connecting terminals and I use them because when the clamp goes onto them, there's lots of a connection on the surface area, lots of surface area connection, I should say. And it just works out very easy. It gives me something perfect to clamp onto when I need to. So that is the negative side, and this is the positive side. And all it is moretted to some smaller gauge appliance wire I had. But you should use the thicker gauge all the way around. It's just I never go higher than about 20 amps on my cell usually, so I don't have to worry too much about it. But I know a lot of guys use high amperage. Use the thickest wire you can find. Okay, so another good thing to remember when you're building your dry cell, when you build a reservoir for it, once you've got your hoses plumbed in and everything's ready to go, drill another hole right near the bottom, put a fitting with a valve on it so that when it comes time to empty your cell, all you got to do is attach a hose, turn a valve, and you can empty into whatever container you want. And that brings up another point of hexavalent chromium. When we use our electrolyte through the stainless steel plates, it will produce hexavalent chromium. It will do it a lot more with 304 plates than 316, but definitely be aware of that. When you take your water out, use gloves. Put it in a container. It's not like you got to be worried about breathing the fumes or anything. Just don't get it on your skin. Put it into a container, cap it, write chromium 6 on it, and just bring it to your toxic depot. I use the same water for like 3 or 4 months in a row, so it's not like you're doing this very often, but when you do it, it's better to be safe than sorry. A lot of guys flush it or put it in the sink. I wouldn't recommend doing that, man. We're just gonna end up with some type of other problem trying to solve a problem, making a bigger one in the end. So anyway, just be aware, don't touch the electrolyte after you've been using it in your cell. Actually, don't touch the electrolyte ever, but make sure you don't get it on your skin, especially after you've been using it for a while, and then bring it to your toxic waste depot. I was gonna say one other thing about dry cells. Don't be fooled by people's claims of liters per minute. When you do a test, make sure your test is with cold water within the first 10 minutes of it running, and that way you're getting more accurate testing, because I have an HHometer, and believe me, if you let your cells run for a long, long time and you let that water get up to high temperatures, which I never do, but if you ever let your water get up to those temperatures, you're just pumping very hot gas into that, and the difference between cool, warm, and hot gas of hydrogen is incredibly different. Hot gas will make that HHometer fill look like it's full in like half the time even. The temperature is very crucial, so when you're doing your tests, make sure you do them with consistently cold water right off the bat, first run of the day, 10 minutes into the run, you know what I mean? So let's make sure that we have accurate liter per minute measurements, because some people claim these ridiculous things and then somebody will buy their cell and it doesn't do what they say, and it's just because their tests were done after running for like 24 hours or something stupid. I would actually recommend, if you want to see the difference of what you think your cell does and what it really does, take your measurements after you've run your cell for a while, and then take your bubbler and fill it with ice and water. So the bubbles have to go through a very cool liquid. And watch the difference in your production when you use it through a bubbler that's full of ice, and then when you use it with a bubbler that's just got regular warm water in it. One last thing, electrolyte. The best electrolyte to use is potassium hydroxide. By far, KOH is the best. But if you can ever get a hold of it, try and get a technical grade potassium hydroxide. It's not so dangerous to your skin, and you don't have to be worried about it dropping all over the place. I can stick my hand right in the solution after I've touched it in there, and then just go rinse it off and not worry about it. It's not as strong as pure potassium hydroxide. One more thing about the cells, the issue of foaming. No Box has had experience now with the his version of foam free. My product's called foam free. I don't know, his has got some type of vitamin E. I have noticed when I used it that it does make the amperage rise because there's more of the plate space being utilized. You hit it right on the ball when you said that. I noticed first in my mini dry cell when I didn't have two ports, when the water level was down to here and this was all full of foam, the amperage was way low. When I'd pour the foam free in, the foam would go away, it would fill with liquid, and the amperage would go up. So you're right about that. I try not to use the foam free as much as possible. I still have no idea what actually causes the foam. We had so many good ideas, but the randomness of it occurring has discounted so many of the theories I had. Like, I had this same water in here from whenever I set this place up in my shop until that video I put out about it starting to foam. And during that whole time, it never foamed once, and then all of a sudden it just appeared out of nowhere, and there was nothing done to the cell, nothing was open, touched. So I'm not sure what the variable is that creates it. Hollywood 7 had a really cool idea, and when I tried it, I didn't bring the reservoir close to my cell enough to make that effect of choking off the float water, water flow, stop the foam. That still is something that could be possible. I'm going to try that next time I exchange the water. I'm going to change my hoses, change the setup, and keep the reservoir closer to the cell. And then we'll see if those cutoff valves choking off the water will actually do what I saw them do in that video, which would be awesome. But anyway, foam free works in the meantime. Just don't use it for nothing, because the cleaner the water, the better it is. During the whole time I had this setup in here, I never used that foam free, by the way. It was just after that video that I put out recently where it was foaming. That was the first time I had to use it in a long time. So anyway, it's there if we need it, but don't use it if we don't have to. Let's try and figure out a way to make it not foam still. And also one more thing for No Box 7, if you want to see dry cell being taken apart after it's ran for a long time, or a wet cell like what I use inside this reservoir being taken apart, for the dry cell one, go to D3's channel. If you don't know what it is, just look up the guys that I subscribe to and you'll see D3's channel there. And if you want to see a wet cell being taken apart, Zero Fossil Fuel takes apart his VSPB cell a few times through his videos there, and you'll see different setups there. And the last thing I want to say about dry cells is between now and between spring, summer, and fall that are coming, there's going to be so much advancement, I guarantee you, on information regarding what we can do to make these cells even more efficient. Yeah, as of now, these cells, the way we're making them, will be useful no matter what technology changes, because this stainless steel can still be utilized no matter what happens. There's cells going to be coming out where the stainless steel has a casing around it, or a sprayed casing around it, and the plates themselves will never even touch the electrolyte. If that comes out, we can still use our stainless steel plates. We just continue the construction from there, so it's never a waste of time building these things. There's going to be resonant circuits. I guarantee you, if you want to see a big company that's using one, go to exogen.ca. If you want to see some really cool videos, go to my favorites and look up the one where Stan Myers has a presentation in Switzerland, and there's a six parts to it. I just have the favorites of the first part, so once you see the first, it'll prompt you for the other parts of it. But Stan Myers has amazing information in there. He's a guy that used a resonant circuit. It's very important that we figure that one out, because it does exist. There are people using it. A guy like Zero Fossil Fuel has got the best chance of figuring it out, and he's determined to figure that out this spring and summer. So, whatever advancements come, these stainless steel designs are still going to be applicable no matter what, so it's not a waste of money. Build them, use the better plates, put as much effort as you can into them, because it's going to be something you'll have for a long time.